Thank you. I want first to say how happy I am to be here with you and to see so many people in this room interested about access to diagnostics and treatment for Hep C. I have no conflict of interest, and now we will be talking about access to epidemiological data, access to screening and diagnostics. We will talk about who is the most at risk, and we will talk about access to treatment in 2014 for low and middle income countries. As you know, when we look at the maps, the prevalence of hepatitis doesn't only concern high-income countries, but predominantly middle-income countries where 70% of the people are expected, of 70% of people affected by hepatitis C are expected to live in low-income countries. If we look at the number of individuals who are co-infected HIV hepatitis C, we cannot say that we don't know where they are. They are in low and middle income countries too, so if we start to screen, we will find patients and we will have to treat them. Access to hepatitis C screening is a game changer. Globally, only 59% of the world's population has no access to screening for hepatitis C. And only 11% of people living in low-income countries have access to screening. When our people tried to validate tests for screening, we had problems. So many false negatives, so many false positives. We could first validate HCV scan and HCV spot, which on average cost $1 to $4 per test. And my organization recommends OraQuick because it's best and most up-to-date performance, but it's also €14 per test. So, if I want to screen people, 30,000 people in the HIV cohort in Myanmar, or 50,000 people in the HIV cohort in Kenya, or 30,000 people in the HIV cohort in Myanmar, I don't have the budget to do so. We don't have, and if we don't have, national governments don't have either. This means that this is a very important first step that is not available at all, and the performance, as you know, is not really good because it's only antibody test. Furthermore, the accuracy for co-infected people is not very well established. If we come back 1 minute about the primary prevention concerning hepatitis C transmission, it's a blood-to-blood contact. And if we look at the patterns of transmission in developed countries, they are not the same as in developing countries. In developing countries, the primary source of hepatitis C infection are unsterilized injection equipment and infusion of inadequately screened blood and blood products. And if we think 1 minute about it, the reservoir of transmission is absolutely huge. MSF has got this gift to get the United Grant so that we can start to screen and treat for Hep C among six of our big HIV cohorts in India, in Iran, Kenya, Mozambique, Myanmar, and Ukraine. And when we started to try to get an idea of the burden of the disease, look at what the kind of data we got. 52% of co-infection in northeastern India, 62% in IDUs in Iran, 10% in Nairobi, Kenya, and 15% in Mozambique, 29% northern Myanmar, 53% among IDUs in Ukraine. So we cannot now forget that these data are there and show us huge prevalence and huge public health problem. Who is the most at risk, given that we cannot screen everybody? Who is the most at risk? This is the next question for us. This is our question today. In India, we could identify that transgender people and people using drugs are very vulnerable groups. In Myanmar, migrants and IDUs. But if you think Myanmar migrants, but so many people need to migrate to get a job. That, once again, the group at risk is huge. In Ukraine, prisoners. complex HIV patients, people who have MDR-TB, TB, men who have sex with men, once again, several vulnerable groups in Iran, commercial sex workers and partners, IDUs. In Mozambique and Kenya, the list is even longer. IDUs, commercial sex workers, blood recipients, invasive medical procedure, tattoos, healthcare workers, prisoners, mobile population. This means how important it is right now for all of us to try to understand the patterns of transmission in our countries and collect solid epidemiological data. This means also for us in MSF that in all our projects, we will be confronted to hepatitis C. As you know, we need to confirm the infection using HCV RNA, and this is another headache given the low availability of the PCR platforms and their high costs. The best first step is to use the HIV platforms, of course. But then, if we consider scaling up and decentralization, we will need access to point-of-care hepatitis C viral loads and flexible PCR platform, like the generic open platforms or Kiagen. Several products are in the pipeline, but not yet available. Today, the costs are totally prohibitive. The best possible package has been dealt in Georgia, where serology, PCR, RNA, and genotype cost $134. But in Nigeria today, or in India, the package is still $500. We still need genotyping, and this is also a high cost, and we still need to assess the liver fibrosis, either using FibroScan or serum biomarker like APRI. What about treatment? Greg said already, the treatment should be simple, highly effective, pan-genotypic, potent, at affordable cost, and easy to take. These are some results from the sofosbuvir-ribavirin. And one thing should be mentioned right now. We are talking about co-infected patients, and in our settings, our co-infectious patients don't have 600 CD4. Most of them, and most of the first people we will have to treat, have advanced liver disease and also advanced HIV disease. This means that they have low CD4 counts, they have low platelets, they have... Everything is fragile. Our first patients will be really fragile. So, for them, we need the best possible combinations, and one drug may not do the job at all, so we cannot assume that sofosbuvir is the solution for us in resource-limited settings. We have to be ambitious in the combinations we aim to get and fight for them. If we look at 5816, fair enough, we are starting to have pangenotypic results, but we are also in a monopoly situation from one single company. And if we want competition, we need also competition from different manufacturers. Why? Because access is driven by competition and driven by free generic competition. Our best choice today would be to have access to sofosbuvir and daclatasvir and put them together. They are very well tolerated, they are very potent, and they would be the drug of choice for our very vulnerable patients. And you know, like me, that Gilead is not happy when I say that because they would like us to promote their combination only. But the truth is also is that now BMS is pursuing the development of the combination, and this is a good thing. But it does not solve today the problem of generic production of these drugs. And this is a very important concern for us. The price is crazy. Fine. So today, if we want to start, if you want to start in new countries, what will be the prices? There is a Gilead access program. In 60 countries, you can have access to lowest tiered pricing category. This means that the negotiations start at $300. Take the opportunity. Take the opportunity to start. This is also the opportunity we take in all our settings except Ukraine and Iran, where the price is still under negotiation, given that Ukraine is considered as Europe for the business market. If you have to buy PEG interferon, and I found that totally a scandal when Edo said we have to pay $300 per vial, you should ask for the Egyptian price, and the Egyptian price is 40 $1 per vial, including ribavirin. If you have to buy ribavirin, make also a good choice. There are good generics like Zydus. You need to buy good quantities, but at least the price starts to be available. So today, the best price for 12 weeks sofosbuvir ribavirin will be $1,126. It's not affordable for all, but it can allow some people to start or some programs to start. But what is the true cost of these drugs, of these combinations? Andrew Hill today, at the same moment as we're talking, is presenting this. This is a poster LBPE12. And he shows that the price of sofosbuvir could be $100 per cure. The price of Daclatasbir could be $20 per cure. If we assume 1 million treatments, which is a certain volume. If we look at the price of a package, MSF says since more than 2 years already the package should be below $500 per cure. Is it a stupidity or is it something possible? Andrew Hill shows us that it is possible. We are not dreaming when we say that this package can be achievable, and we could try to simplify the diagnosis package using and validating HCV antigen for screening and monitoring. But for all the main combinations, the package is below $500. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, there are several interventions to overcome access barrier to Hep C treatment. The first of all will be our mobilization, the civil society mobilizations, the patient groups mobilization to teach us how to take care of them. As you understood, we need access to reliable epidemiological data, and we need to understand the patterns of transmission. We need to fight for access to reliable and affordable diagnostics, and WHO has a huge role to play there. We need access to care without discrimination, including people who use drugs who are welcome in MSF programs. We need these demonstration projects where we will show the performance, the feasibility at large scale, how to simplify, how to task shift, train people, including all the components, screening, prevention, harm reduction, and treatment. We need free generic competition, and we will achieve this goal of a package below $500 per cure. There are many people to thank, because this work is not done by one person alone. I want to thank the chairs. I want to thank IAC team, the WHO team, which is also working very hard, the Hep C Guideline Development Group, the huge MSF team, which is now working on viral hepatitis, Liverpool University, Bristol, London School, United team, and also my Geneva University Hospital team. Thank you.